Shalom, brothers and sisters. I pray that you are blessed. Oh my goodness. Father is so amazing. I have some absolutely just amazing, magnificent, just as he has indicated in the vision of the clock and the celestials. I'm really going to try not to get ahead of myself because this is super exciting. I am absolutely honored to bring it forth. I just can't want us to get started by giving Father Ahiah all of the glory. He alone is worthy to be praised, honored, and glorified. I give him all of the thanksgiving. Holy Yeshaya, our Mashiach, and Holy Spirit, Ruach HaKodesh. Wow, 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 wow. Okay, so let's get started. This shouldn't be very long, but I just want to give you a heads up. We want to be thorough as we receive this mana. And if you have received a vision, a dream of this celestial clock in the heavenlies. Because why? Because the heavens declare Father's glory. If you have been shown this, please share, because now more than ever, Father wants us working together in unity. Okay, I'm going to leave it at that. Give me just a second. Okay, so I'm going to walk you through this the way it has been given to me. Okay. And I may be leaving out a couple of pieces that if I have to add them, I will at a later date. But I do have to come forth now. So with this in mind, with the key of David, I place the cloak of invisibility over this communication, over our minds, bodies, spirits, and hearts in Holy Yeshaya's name. Heavenly Father, I ask for your outpouring of your fresh anointing, Father, that fresh anointing of your oil. Place it upon our heads, Heavenly Father. Give us a heart to listen, a heart to learn, Heavenly Father, what you are revealing in this hour regarding your great Maseroth, the constellations. Oh my goodness. Okay, so let me start with the title. Okay. Father specifically gave me these words to title this. He gave it to me in a dream, and he said, about that clock, dot, dot, dot. Those were his words. Those were his words, okay? So, now, in the last couple oh my goodness, I don't even know where to get started. Okay, so, in a previous word, a segment of the Maseroth, Father had me do and share this vision that he gave me. I'm going to go over the vision again so you know where this is stemming from, okay? I will get to that into that in just a minute, and I will share that link with you in the comments once I upload this, okay? So please be patient with me. All right, so let's get started here. Okay, you guys got your popcorn? I seriously about broke my fast to pop some popcorn so that we could share in this festivities. Okay, here we go, guys. All right. So as we know in Father's Word in Genesis chapter 1, verse 14 and 15, and not only in that scripture, but this is the one that he has me use often in these videos. In this word, it says, then God said, let there be lights in the firmament. We have learned that that is starlight. We were given that, I think, on the third segment of the Maseroth. Okay. So again, then God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heavens to divide the day from the night, and let them be for what? Signs. He says signs first. Let them be for signs and seasons, and for days, timekeeping, and years. And let them be for lights in the firmament of the heavens to give light on the earth, and it was so. Okay. So Father has given these things to us as an inheritance, okay? As a heritage, he has given this to us, the heavenlies. And they are to tell time and seasons, and the signs, of course, will be used to let us know what chapter we're in prophecy, right? To navigate, right? So this is very, very key that you pay attention to detail, because this is absolutely amazing. When Father said in that video where I shared about the vision of the constellation being inset on the watch faceplate, Father gave me understanding that this was magnificent. Okay, this was something out of this world. larger than life, guys. Okay, he just popped that in my mouth. All right. We also learn in Matthew chapter 2, verse 1 through 2, we read of the celestial timekeeping by the Magi, the three wise men, okay? The sky was their compass. The heavenlies were their compass. The star of Bethlehem is where they were, what they were seeking, right? In the eastern skies. It was their celestial guide, right? And please forgive me because I'm all tongue twisted, but it's because I'm excited. So I don't want to apologize for that either, because I want you to share in this excitement, because this is for all of us. This isn't just for a small group of us. This is for the body of Christ. This is absolutely extraordinary. All right, so let's go down to the vision. So on April the 5th, 2024, I was shown a vision of what appeared to be a watch. I was given the word a sundial, and within it was what appeared to be the constellations. Time, I was given time dial. It appeared to be moving counterclockwise. So the opposite of a normal clock, of clockwise, right? Counterclockwise can represent something being opened, unlocked, or reverting back to, like back to the future. Back, excuse me. I had mentioned about 1984, where I was placed in that dream, and I was in 1984. Many of us have been shown visions and dreams where we're taking back into time, perhaps to bring people to salvation. We don't know all of the, you know, magnificence that Father has planned for us, but just to explain that. And please, again, if you haven't watched the previous video, I just want to just give you a heads up. I'm recovering from a little bit of oral surgery, so thenceforth it's harder for me to talk. So please forgive me. I'm not trying to be disrespectful or anything by clearing my throat and whatnot. I don't want to agitate anybody, but I truly want to just speak this word, the findings that Father has given us, and I want you to join in my excitement, because this is for all of us, like I said. Okay, so let's get to reading this again for clarity. On April 5th, 2024, I was shown a vision of what appeared to be a watch. A sundial is what I was given. And within it was what appeared to be the constellation wheel, right? I received the word time dial. It appeared to be moving counterclockwise, which counterclockwise tends to open, unlock, or revert back to a time, because I was given the word time, right? All right. Since this vision, Father has granted us great insight on what he is revealing. He was showing us a celestial clock, this sundial in the heavenlies, portrayed in the heavens through the constellation, through his masterpiece, the great Maseroth, which Maseroth renders in the Hebrew constellations. Okay, so solarium is Latin for sundial. Okay, remember, I was given sundial. I didn't even know what a sundial was, to be quite honest with you, but I was given the word. I had to look this up. I had to research the matter, right? So solarium is Latin for sundial. It was a constellation located between the constellations of, and pay close attention the way this is laid out, okay? It is a constellation located between the constellations of Horologium, Dorado, and Hydrus. Dorado is going to come into play here very soon, because that's the next words I was given. I was given El Dorado twice last night. Okay, so that will come into play again, waiting on Father to instruct me, to lead me, so that I can look these things up, do the research, and share them with you. And if you have received any of this knowledge, so that we can come together collectively and learn about his celestial clock, his horologium, okay? This is really important, because that prefix of that word I mentioned in a different video. Horo is, for the Latin, is oro, which means, or in Spanish, oro, which means gold. And that has been coming up here recently in this series of the Maseroth. some of these words are rendering with the prefix of gold. Okay, so let me just go here. Hold on. This is what a sundial is. Okay, an instrument that shows the time by the shadow from the sun on a pointer. The steps in 2 Kings chapter 20, verse 9 through 11. I will include that scripture if I don't have it on here. I will include it. It's very, very interesting. It can also be translated in degrees. The size and design of the sundial of Ahaz, is not certain. Neither is how much time is meant by 10 degrees or steps. This is very key to what we're going to learn. All right. Now, the Essenes, they also went and lived by a solar calendar, right? But they went by the sundial for time, for signs, and all of this to keep time keeping. That's what Father just gave me. Again, reiterating time keeping, right? This was the form that they used there. Up on the upper left there is one of the ancient relics that they found, that they found there in Qumran. All right, so this is the Horologium. And I please pardon me if I'm mispronouncing that. Give me just a second. I want to think of... No, that's the way they pronounced it, Horologium. So this is that celestial clock in the heavenlies. This is the Horologium constellation, okay? Visibly, it is a clock, right? All right. So just so you follow along here. Now, in Isaiah chapter 38, verse 8, we learn about this, how sun travels, right? So it says here, God made the sun travel backwards. If he made the sun travel backwards, then obviously he went back into time. He was able to change the hour, right, by the sun. And it says, behold, I will bring again the shadow of the degrees, which is gone down in the sundial of Ahaz, 10 degrees backward, back in time, right? Counterclockwise, going backward, reverting back to, right? So the sun returned 10 degrees, by which degrees it was gone down. This is how amazing this is, as you can see. Horologium is Latin, I found out. For what? For clock. You guys, you can't make this up. Horologium is Latin for clock. An astronomical clock, horologium, or horloj, or in Spanish, reloj, is a clock with special mechanisms and dials to display astronomical information, such as the relative positions of the sun, the moon, zodiacal constellations, and sometimes major planets. Okay? The constellation was located in the southern skies between Horologium, the clock, okay, Hydrus, the sea snake, and Dorado, the goldfish. Here we are again with the gold, guys. Dorado in Spanish has a reference of gold. And we were talking about Horologium. Oro is the prefix is and stems from gold. The constellation was never widely accepted by astronomers and is rarely mentioned today. There is absolutely a reason why it's not mentioned today, because they don't want you to know, and they don't want you to be able to tell the signs in the sky. They don't want you to time keep. They've kept this from us. They have changed the clocks to the traditional, you know, dumbed down clocks. It's nothing like the way it used to be, guys. And remember, Father's reminding me of this now. The gospel was written in the stars before the apostles penciled them on paper. In their case, papyrus paper, it was the choice paper used in ancient times. Okay, so this was all Father's craftsmanship, his masterpiece in the skies. And he's showing it, he's revealing it to us, guys. Horologium constellation in the southern sky at about 3 hours right ascension and 50 degrees south in declination. Its brightest star is Alpha Horologi, again, Horo being oro, gold. So that's coming up again, with a magnitude of 3.9. The constellation of Horologium, the celestial pendulum clock. Okay, this was before they started giving us these Mickey Mouse clocks, right? The celestial pendulum clock is a faint constellation that is visible in the southern celestial hemisphere. Horologium was originally named Horologium Oscillatorium, which translates to the pendulum clock. The French astronomer Nicolas-Louis de L'Isle, pardon me, formed this constellation in 1754. It represents a pendulum clock. And what is meant by he formed this constellation is it means formed, meaning he described and first visualized it as a clock, right? With a pendulum and a second hand. We can also see this spiritually regarding the kingdom, right? This gospel of the kingdom that shall be preached throughout the nations has everything to do. It is the heavenlies are mirroring the kingdom in the earth. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in the earth as it is in heaven. It is a mirror. Okay? It is a mirror. Thank you, Heavenly Father. When I was shown the vision of the constellation's inset on the watch faceplate, okay, it was moving counterclockwise, as I mentioned. Time was going backwards, okay, unlocking, going back into time, thus the dream of 1984 and being positioned in 1984. The following scripture depicts this, okay? Now, we know that we have already seen the sign of Jonah. Undeniably, we've all seen this. The sign of Jonah, the total solar eclipse on April 8th, 2024. This has started the clock for 40 days of repentance. As watchwomen, we should be occupying right now this time to bring those to repentance, bring those to salvation, right? Why? Because behold, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. It is literally at hand. All right, so then we see this internally, right? The kingdom within. We see in Matthew chapter 18, verse 3 to 4, truly I tell you, unless you change, unless you be converted, unless you go back to the time before, okay? Unless you change and be converted and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom. Therefore, whoever takes the lowly position of this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. I pray that you can see the connection to this picture right here. We're going back to the clock was going counterclockwise, indicating going backwards, going reverting, converting back into children spiritually, okay? That is the whole ministry of the kingdom within. We have to self-reflect, okay? And we cannot be in that sin willingly. However, Father is so graceful and he is so merciful that if you confess your sin and repent genuinely and what? Turn away from your sin. Okay? Repenting is a changing of mind. Unless we convert and return with the heart posture of a child, we shall not inherit the kingdom. The word says this. Verily I say unto you, unless you be converted as children, you shall not inherit the kingdom. So you can see how this pendulum, this horologium, sorry. This horologium in the heavenlies, Father is showing what he's allowing for us to do at this hour is to go back and return to him. And he will heal our land. He will hear our lament if we will just listen, if we will just be converted in our minds, in our bodies, hearts, and spirit. All right, so let's move forward here. This describes it perfectly, the horologium, okay? Acts chapter 3, verse 19, repent and return. What is it doing? It's going counterclockwise so that your sins may be wiped away. Repent and return so that your sins may be wiped away. Be converted. Go back to Him. Here we read in Luke chapter 13, verse 3 through 5. Jesus warned us several times, unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The kingdom of heaven is here. And if you're going to be preaching this gospel of the kingdom throughout all the nations, and then the end will come, you absolutely have to know yourself. You have to know about the kingdom. And where is the kingdom? Within. This is how you're converted. This is one of my favorite edifying scriptures here in Acts chapter 3, verse 19 through 21. Repent ye therefore. We're in the 40 days of, we're in the gap of the span of the 40 days of repentance since April 8th, right? Repent ye therefore and be converted, be changed, go back, revert, that your sins may be blotted out when the times of refreshing. And Father said the other day, we are in the time, now is the time of refreshing, shall come from the presence of the Lord, and he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you, whom the heaven must receive until the times of restitution of all things, which God had spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. This is so awesome. Okay, so we know that typically we enter this world, the matrix, upside down, right? With the crown being exposed to the world first. We then must be converted, right? We must be changed because we come into a sinful world. We then must be converted and go up the mountain, which is the mountaintop, right? I'm just going to show you this image here. We come into the world, we come into the matrix, head down first, right? And we must be converted. So that means we have to turn up. We need to be converted so we can go what? Up the mountain. All right, here we go. Well, what's the mountain, you might say? Well, the Bible is allegory. The Bible is written in heavy code. Just about every time you see the word mount or mountain in it, it's referring to the top. How many times have you all heard in your dreams and visions, in your audibles, come up hither, come up higher, right? Which means your brain. The proper way to interpret the book is to merely relate it to self, because you must know yourselves. You must know yourselves. Lastly, I leave you with this. Psalms chapter 24, verse 3 to 4. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or swear by a false god. I absolutely pray that this has blessed you. This is absolutely all the glory to Father Ahaya. I am so excited about it because I see what Father's doing. He is gathering the flock. He is uniting what has become divided by religious spirits, doctrines where people want to argue and debate, and that is not of Father. Father is love, and love is our message. Those are words Father gave to me as a banner for his priests that have been preaching this gospel of the kingdom faithfully for several years now. I will include those priests' names and channel links, and I will also include Queen Esther with Beloved Grace Ministries as she goes forth to illustrate the Bible in the body and how you must know yourselves to inherit the kingdom of heaven. Indeed, this gospel of the kingdom that shall be preached throughout the nations, and then the end will come. I love you so much, brothers and sisters. I pray that you are as excited as I am. Holy is Yeshaya.